So let's look at these truths together. Brokenness, how it reflects the heart of God. You know, God's not looking for the strong and mighty. That's one of the beautiful things about who God is. He's no respecter of persons. And what's beautiful about this text in John 4 is when the disciples go to town to get some food, leaving Jesus at the well, he meets this Samaritan woman who was not only an outcast in the Jewish community, but she was an outcast in her very own Samaritan community. Why do we know that? For a few reasons. One, in John 4, 6, and 7, tells us it was the sixth hour. It's an important detail. That means it was noon. Now, noon in a Middle Eastern sun is the hottest part of the day. And I lived in the East for many years where I saw how the women draw water in India. Never you'll see someone go in the middle of the day to draw water. So here she is by herself because she didn't want to associate with the other younger women.
Abounding in Faith is the broadcast ministry of Emmanuel Bible Church of Howell, New Jersey. If you are blessed by this message, please subscribe to our podcast or YouTube channel. You can also download our app by searching for IBCNJ in the Google Play Store or the Apple Store. For more information, please visit us at www.ibcnj.org. Our speaker today is Senior Pastor Joe Suozzo.
We're going to turn to John chapter 4, so if you have your Bibles with you, stay standing, moms. I know this is a case of endurance. But I promise next year we're going to have this better organized, I guarantee it. But I do want to get into the text of Scripture before noon today. And John chapter 4, we're going to look at the text of the Samaritan woman. And this is a wonderful text, and our subject today is going to be on brokenness and the heartache that we all face in this life, especially moms who carry a unique pain in raising children. I could see some of the moms say, yeah. And I can't say I know your pain, but I can see it. It's a unique pain in raising children. But the good news is that in Christ, in Jesus, he's there to meet us every step of the way. And I think this account of the Samaritan woman that we're going to read today shows us how Jesus can uniquely meet all of us, especially moms. Yeah. No, they're going to stand for God's word. You know, let me tell you something. I went to a Russian Orthodox church for a funeral, and I had to stand for 3 hours. So moms, buck up. You know, this is, you know, middle-class evangelicalism is easy street compared to a Russian Orthodox church. Let's stand for a reading of God's word. We're going to pick it up in John chapter 4, verses 5, and we're going to read all the way through 26. So Jesus comes to a town in Samaria called Sychar, near the field that Jacob had given to his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there. So Jesus, wearied as he was from his journey, was sitting beside the well. It was about the sixth hour. Now his disciples went to town to get some food. So he's here by himself by the well. A woman from Samaria came to draw water, and Jesus said to her, "Give me a drink." The Samaritan woman said to him, "How is it that you, a Jew, ask me for a drink, a woman from Samaria?" For Jews have no dealings with Samaritans. And Jesus answered, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is that is saying to you, 'Give me a drink,' you would have asked him and he would have given you living water." The woman said to him, "Sir, you have nothing to draw with, and the well is deep. Where do you get that living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob? He gave us the well and drank from it himself, as did his sons and his livestock. And Jesus said to her, everyone who drinks of this water will be thirsty again, but whoever drinks of the water that I will give him will never thirst again. The water that I give will become in him a spring of water welling up to eternal life. The woman said to him, sir, give me some of this water so that I may not be thirsty or have to come here to draw water. And Jesus said to her, go call your husband and come here. And the woman answered him, I have no husband. And Jesus said, you are right in saying I have no husband, for you have had five husbands, and the one you're now with is not your husband. What you have said is true. The woman said to him, sir, I perceive that you're a prophet. Our fathers worshipped on this mountain, but you say that in Jerusalem is a place where people ought to worship. And Jesus said to her, woman, believe me, the hour is coming when neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem will you worship the Father. You worship what you do not know. We worship what we know, for salvation is from the Jews. But the hour is coming and is now here when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth, for the Father is seeking such people to worship him. God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship him in spirit and truth. The woman said to him, I know the Messiah is coming. He who is called the Christ. When he comes, he will tell us all things. And Jesus said to her, I who speak to you am he. Father, such an amazing portion of scripture. We pray as we just unpack it and look at its details that you'd speak to our hearts. We thank you, Lord, that you're not looking for the strong, the mighty, the rich and the wise. But Lord, you look for those who are humble, contrite, broken, and willing to listen. And so we pray that we would have those hearts this morning. In Christ's name, amen. You may be seated. You know, in this text, we see several amazing truths, I think, that will speak deeply to our hearts this morning. And the first is this: Jesus is able to meet every one of us in our brokenness. In fact, brokenness is an opportunity to reflect something about the love and heart of God. Here is a broken woman who is living in an adulterous relationship and who had five previous husbands. No matter what the context, no matter what the time, her life had to be filled with so much tragedy and pain. A second truth is this: our brokenness can also be a place where we come to know God intimately, to depend on him in a greater way. Her brokenness led to an incredible conversation with Jesus, where she learned about Jesus, the living water. And then the final truth we're going to see in the text is this: brokenness in the human condition is God's way to show us his mercy and love. We deserve judgment. We deserve alienation and separation because of our sin. But God's love opened the way through Christ, not only to be forgiven, but also to discover that there's living water that can rush through us to become a spring to give to others. Isn't that beautiful? So let's look at these truths together. Brokenness, how it reflects the heart of God. You know, God's not looking for the strong and mighty. That's one of the beautiful things about who God is. He's no respecter of persons. And what's beautiful about this text in John 4 is when the disciples go to town to get some food, leaving Jesus at the well, he meets this Samaritan woman who was not only an outcast in the Jewish community, but she was an outcast in her very own Samaritan community. Why do we know that? For a few reasons. One, in John 4, 6, and 7, tells us it was the sixth hour. It's an important detail. That means it was noon. Now, noon in a Middle Eastern sun is the hottest part of the day. And I lived in the East for many years where I saw how the women draw water in India. Never you'll see someone go in the middle of the day to draw water. So here she is by herself because she didn't want to associate with the other younger woman in the morning. Another detail of the text that shows us her destitution and brokenness is in verse 17, 18. Of course, not only living with a man at the present time, but also divorced five times. This is no doubt a divine appointment that God himself had orchestrated. And I believe the lesson is simple here. God is not on the hunt for the successful or those who have it together. I can't even tell you how much it grieves me when I hear from somebody that has been around, not around for a few weeks at the church, and I say, "Where have you been?" "I was just feeling awful and I didn't want to come. I was just feeling so downcast and so alienated from God." Can I just tell you guys something? That's the time you need to come. Amen. That's God's way of speaking to your heart and saying, you know, you need to be with other believers worshiping and hearing some transcendent truth that'll bring you out from that place of brokenness and despair. You see, the brokenness is God's way of revealing his love, his mercy, his compassion. Psalm 34, we read this amazing verse of scripture. The Lord is close to the brokenhearted. He saves those who are crushed in spirit. Again, in Psalm 51, God tells us a true sacrifice to God is a broken spirit and a contrite heart. And of course, Jesus reminded us in this great Sermon on the Mount, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of God. You see, from Genesis all the way through Revelation, there's one concurrent theme that God reaches out to those who are downcast. That the only problem is us. Instead of looking up, we're looking either towards man or we're looking down at ourselves. Why, according to the psalmist, is God close to the brokenhearted? Why would he save those who are crushed in spirit? Why does God extend an invitation to bless those who are hungry, thirsty, and poor? Because it's a place to reveal something about who he is. That's our purpose. To reflect his glory. To reflect the goodness of God. Jeremiah the prophet tells us, cursed is the man who trusts in man, who depends on his flesh. He then goes on to say he's like a tree planted in the wilderness and does not see any fruit. But blessed is the man who trusts in the Lord, whose trust is the Lord. He's like a tree that sends out its roots to the streams and it does not fear the heat of day, because it never ceases to bear fruit. It's a beautiful, beautiful text to remind us that when we point ourselves to the things of God, blessing follows. God desires to reveal himself to a broken world. And the way he does that is not through strength, but through weakness. And that leads to something else here that we discover in the text. That through this interaction between Jesus and this Samaritan woman, we see something about the tenderness of God. You know, it's important that you do see that, the love of God, the tenderness of God. Because some of us, and I've been there, feel our inadequacies so deeply, feel our failures so deeply that we think somehow that God is so disappointed with us that I can't even raise my eyes to see him. But you see, this is a lie of the devil. He's trying to convince you that somehow you are the arbitrator between yourself and God. That's not the case. Christ is. Christ is the one who came to reconcile us to a holy God through his shed blood. And now, through him, I can lift up my eyes to heaven. And we see the tenderness of God here. She's a thirsty, broken soul. And God orchestrates a divine appointment to show his tender love. She was a desperate woman with a trail of broken relationships and most likely children from a variety of blended families. Who knows the conflict, the bitterness that was going on in that family? Nancy Lee DeMoss, in her book Brokenness, writes this: contrary to what we would expect, brokenness is the pathway to blessing. There is no alternative routes. The very thing we dread, the very thing we're tempted to resist, is actually the means to God's greatest blessing in our lives. An interesting detail here in the text is how the disciples, when coming back from the town, were surprised that Jesus was conversing with a Samaritan woman. They were surprised first that he was conversing with a woman, period. That didn't happen in the Middle East. And secondly, a Samaritan woman, an outcast. But Jesus' time with her shows us, I believe, the tenderness of God. And, you know, also, Jesus was never concerned about social convention. Notice that? Or man's opinion? And so, the first thing we see here in our text is that brokenness reflects the heart of God. Second truth here: brokenness can be a pathway to knowing God deeply. And the first thing I want us to see, look at verse 9 with me, is just the shame and inadequacy of who we are. Samaritan woman felt the shame of who she was. Jews and Samaritans hated each other, as our text states in verse 9. They didn't associate with one another. Samaritans were considered half-breeds, a mixed race, and perceived by the Jews who lived in the south and the north of them as inferior and pure. The Samaritans emerged after the Assyrian invasion, when the Assyrians invaded Israel in the 7th century. And they subjugated them and took them back to Assyria, slaves, the northern kingdom of Israel. And then it was their policy to bring Assyrians back into that territory, to intermarry and to intermingle and to bring their gods so that they could wash the culture and subjugate the people. This was God's judgment upon northern Israel for idolatry and disobedience to God's word. You can read about this in Kings, Chronicles, the prophets of Hosea, Joel, Amos, Obadiah, Jonah, and Micah. All this is there. Assyria was ruthless towards the nations it conquered. It exiled all the skilled laborers, all the landowners as slaves, conquered territories, and many horrific things. They came down in history as one of the most brutal empires of the ancient world. And so as these Gentiles married and commingled with the existing Jews, becoming half-breeds, Samaritans, adapting pagan beliefs and things that were odious and repugnant to the Jewish people, the Jews did not associate with the Samaritans, and so she was looked down upon. She's broken and bitter because of this. How do we know that? Look at verse 9. How could you ask me for a drink? Now, think about the tone of voice that she could have had. I mean, if she's from New Jersey, how could you ask me for water? And verse 20, we worship in this area, but you people, now if she was from Jersey, you people, you worship in Jerusalem. You see, the Samaritans of half-breed Jews and people of history of being enslaved were bitter towards the Jews in the south and the north of them. Jesus being one of them. You know, I spent a lot of time with people with this kind of pain. A number of years in India, our group that we were ministering to were called the Untouchables. Now, in India, there are four castes and then what's called non-caste or Untouchables. And the Untouchables got that name, Untouchable, because it's not so much practiced today except for certain villages, but in the cities not so much. But the Untouchables, even if their shadow would fall on a higher caste, they would be beaten for it. And so when we arrived in some of the first villages that we were ministering to of these Untouchable people, they had such a low view of themselves. And then we came in with the gospel of Jesus Christ. The gospel that says you're created in the image of God. That through Christ you can become his child. That through him he has a purpose and a destination that's glorious. And right here now, you are an image bearer of God and he desires to change you. You know, that simple message transformed that community. If you were to go back there today, it's unrecognizable, the attitude difference. That's what the gospel can do. It transforms the heart and mind. You see, it's a pathway, brokenness, a pathway to know God. The pain of our mistakes, our failures, can be the very conduit that God wants to use. Look at verse 16. Jesus, the master teacher here, he calls for her husband. Look at her response, I have no husband. She thought she was off the hook. Do you think that? I think that. She was trying to avoid an uncomfortable situation. And Jesus said, you're right when you say you have no husband. The fact is you've had five, and the man you're now with is not your husband. You see, at that moment, she says, I perceive you're a prophet. She understood he was from God. Is Jesus being mean here? You know, when he begins by pointing out your failure and your inadequacy, your weakness. Is God being mean to come help you come to face with who you really are and to stop pretending? No. That's his kindness, because truth leads to freedom and liberation. Let's just transport ourselves just for a few minutes into this woman's life. Five husbands and currently living with man. I just can't even imagine the conflict this poor woman endured. She was probably beautiful to attract five men into her life. Perhaps she was the root of the problem, or perhaps every man that came into her life, some beat her, mistreated her. The children, the stepchildren, the bitterness that swirled around her life. I just can't imagine. I can only know some of those broken families I've entered into that have half the history of this. She felt the pain of a failed life. A life filled with mistakes and dysfunction. a life filled with many broken relationships. Here she is in the middle of the day, 6 hour, sun scorching, trying to avoid interacting with the younger women in the village, and there Jesus is to meet her in that place. When the gospel first went to the Gentiles, that's the non-Jews in the first century, the apostle Peter was so disgusted by the thought that it took 3 visions and a dream from God to move Peter's heart. So when Jesus is standing there, she no doubt felt judged, even though he didn't come to judge her. There is an inherent attitude. Even in Peter, the apostle, walked with Christ for 3 years, he had this attitude, there's no way that he would associate with a Gentile. But listen to what God said to Peter in the vision in Acts 10. I love it. God accepts all men from every nation who fear him and do what is right. God is all-inclusive. Paul, the apostle, writes it this way in Galatians 3:28. There's neither Jew nor Greek, slave nor free, male nor female, for you are all one in Christ. I think it's just an amazing thing that God is willing to reach out to anyone who's willing to respond to him. Isn't that beautiful? So what stops man from tasting of the goodness of God? It certainly is not God. It's the heart of man. So brokenness reflects something about God. Brokenness can be a pathway to knowing God. And then final truth here, brokenness can be a way to receive God's mercy in Jesus. Look at verse 10 with me. Jesus said, "If you knew who it was who asked of you." But she didn't know. She's ignorant here. It's an amazing discourse. This broken woman is standing before the Creator of the heavens and the earth, by whom, the scripture says, all things were made. Not one thing was made without him. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. He is the radiance of God's glory. By his power, he upholds the universe. So many scriptures. And when he became man, to many he was unrecognizable. He said, Jesus, if you knew, but you didn't. Look at verses 10 and 11 with me. If you knew the gift of God and who it is that's saying to you, give me a drink, you would have asked him. I love that. Just ask, you'll receive. Knock, the door will be opened to you. But the woman said, you have asked him and he would have given you living water. The woman said, sir, you have nothing to draw with and the well is deep. Where do you get this living water? She still doesn't understand. Reminds me of the previous chapter when Nicodemus, high priest, learned of Israel, one of the most learned men of Israel. Jesus says, you must be born again to enter the kingdom of God. He says, what, do you have to enter the womb a second time? They couldn't understand that Jesus was speaking in spiritual metaphors and truths. Her focus was on the practical reality of retrieving a few gallons of water here, bringing them back for her daily chores, which included cleaning, cooking. Jesus is trying to break through her world, extend to her an invitation of receiving the living water, which is Christ himself. She's struggling to understand what Jesus is offering here, but Jesus is patient. Isn't that good news? He's patient with us. I know I was hard-headed. I remember the very first time that I clearly was confronted with the gospel in a way that I understood. I was in India traveling as a hippie, wound up in this square in the middle of the night in the mountains with my guitar, And this young guy saw me, and I didn't know where I was going to go. He says, you want to come and stay at my place? My father will allow you to stay there. And so I wound up in their attic, kind of loft area. And the next morning, I remember this, he's feeding me these things called Italy's. They're these like rice cakes. It's delicious. And while he's giving me this wonderful breakfast, he begins to open up the scripture and read it to me and challenge me. I never forgot that kindness. Maybe it was that planted seed. And I remember when I was in Long Branch after traveling and coming back, I used to play on the baseball team, and there's this African-American gentleman, Tyrone, who we got close on the baseball team. He was a shortstop, I was second baseman, and he came to me to share the gospel. And I remember I was so convicted, I ran away from Tyrone. But by God's grace, he kept on pursuing me with messengers and the word. He's patient. He's patient with us. He's trying to break through her world, extend to her an invitation to receive living water, which is himself. She's focused on the water of this world. But Jesus is inviting her to something greater. So Jesus tells her how she can get out of her brokenness and alienation. If you knew the gift of life and who it is that's saying to you, give me a drink, you would have asked him and he would have given you living water. What she needed to know was Jesus. You see, Jesus is the one who transforms a broken heart. Three amazing statements here. Look at verses 13 and 14. Everyone who drinks of this water, not the living water, will thirst again. That's the first one. What water is he talking about? The water of the world. You know, I was thinking of this verse this morning. I added into my sermon. 2 Timothy 3:7. There's some people who are always learning. In other words, they're always churning, they're always trying to satisfy a thirst, but never coming to a knowledge of truth. Isn't that a sad testimony on a life? You know, you have a whole world out there seeking to find water to satisfy from dried up wells that can never do the job, because Jesus is the only one. He's the only one who can satisfy. He's the only one who can truly satiate that thirsty soul that's longing to know God and be filled with him. Everyone who drinks this water, Jesus said, will be thirsty again. This is the world and all it has to offer. World's solutions, temporary. You get a bit of a drink, you think you're satisfied, you wake up the next day, thirsty again. Our culture is learning this, I think, more than ever post-COVID, as anxiety and depression and so many other phobias are just rising in great number from the social isolations and the changes in our culture. But then look at verse 14 with me. And I love it here. But whoever drinks the water I give him will never thirst. That's the core message of the gospel. That Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. That's why he came, that we may be reconciled with God and discover all the fullness of what we've been created to be. And so looking for something that our hearts long for in other places is an absolute act of foolishness from a kingdom perspective. God's saying, come to me, you who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. A few chapters later in John 7, Jesus stood up in the temple area and says, all you are thirsty, come to me and drink. As the scripture says, whoever believes in me out of his heart will spring up wells, springs of living water. And that leads us to this last truth there in verse 14. A spring of water wells up to eternal life. The way I look at this, and I know this from personal experience. Before Christ, I was a taker. I was looking for things to satisfy my soul. Before Christ, I was always kind of looking for that opportunity or that situation that would make me feel better or give me a little bit of peace. But then something miraculous happened when I received Christ as Savior. Not only did he begin to heal my broken, empty heart, but then something began to bubble up, and then I began to become a giver, a servant, one who has something to give others rather than a taker. And guess what? It's more blessed to give than receive. It's better, it's more joy to our soul to be in a posture of having something to give somebody instead of asking them for something they could never give. And so Jesus said, you who receive me, this living water, will become a spring of water welling up to eternal life. Just one final truth here and we'll finish up. Jesus always confronts us with our sins that holds us back. Sometimes I don't like that. I don't like sometimes to have areas of my life that I don't like revealed. She still didn't understand. She knows she's got a very unique interaction going on here. But there was something in her holding back. She was a woman who was looking for love in all the wrong places. Her sin was looking towards relationships, probably, a thirsty heart. But Jesus is saying here that the secret of spiritual vitality and health is to go to him first, a spring of water welling up in eternal life. And you know what's interesting about this? The first person, as far as we understand from all the scriptures, that Christ reveals himself as the Messiah and the Christ of Israel, was to this Samaritan woman. To me, that's just amazing. It's like God's putting his exclamation point and saying, listen, all of you have opportunity to come to me and discover this living water. But if there's anything that's holding you back, it's you, not Christ. I don't know where you're at this morning. Maybe you know Christ and you're just looking to be satisfied in other things than him. Well, you know Christ as Savior, return to him. Put him first. Let him produce the joy in you, that the peace in you that only he can provide. That's for you as a believer. But if you're here this morning, maybe mom grabbed you by the ear and dragged you in. I don't know how you got here. And you don't know Christ, but there's something that's convicting you about this message. You sense that emptiness in your soul. The good news is this, that everyone who calls upon the name of the Lord will be saved. Good news? How many people can do it? Everyone. Whosoever believes in him would not perish, but have everlasting life. How many is whosoever? I don't know where you're at, but if you're here watching through YouTube or Facebook, or you're here this morning and you don't know Christ as Savior, can I challenge you maybe to bow your head today? Today could be the day, Mom's Day. What better day to do it, right? To everyone who goes to Jesus, Jesus says, this living water, out of his heart will flow springs of living water. Isn't that a beautiful promise? Let's pray. Father, thank you for the word of God and just the amazing text of scripture here. Thank you for how you extend an invitation to all. And Lord, I pray for each one here this morning that we understand our failures and brokenness and our condition in life can become a great open door for your love, for your work in our lives. Help us to see that and to surrender to you. For those who know Christ, Lord, I pray they would just seek you all the more and leave this place a little bit more transformed, a little bit more with the motivation to put you first. And for anyone who doesn't know Christ, again, today, Mother's Day, maybe that day, to bow that knee and say, I receive you, Christ, for the forgiveness of sin. I receive you, Jesus, for my brokenness, because you are broken, with the promise that you would not perish, but have everlasting life. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.